Yeah, I've been doing A-level biology and chemistry, and in particular I've been interested in genetics that we've been studying in biology, and I'd like to explore that a bit further as well at university and beyond.
Right, is there anything else you've been doing to further your interest in genetics?
Yeah, I did a project recently over my summer holidays working in a lab in Oxford, where we looked at BRCA1 and BRCA2 genes in breast cancer, and we looked at inhibiting certain pathways, and I'm hoping to get a paper out of that. We're writing that at the moment.
That sounds really interesting. Yeah. That's really great.
Yeah, and we looked at an inhibitor for a certain pathway that's used to repair defective or damaged DNA, and we found that this worked in sort of culture models, and we're trying to now use that in animal models to see if that works over there as well.
Well, great, then I think you'll be liking what we're doing in the interview today. So I thought we'd do some genetics questions.
Okay.
So I thought we'd start. Could you draw a Mendel square for a recessive disorder? So could you name a recessive disorder and draw a Mendel square for it?
Yes, okay.
Okay, so a recessive disorder that comes to mind would be something like sickle cell disease. So a Mendel square would maybe look something like this, where we have mother's side over here and father's genes over here. And if I draw a capital A and a little a denoting one of the different alleles for the same gene, and again, for the father, assuming they're both carriers, they both have one each, you could have, I would suppose, four types of inheritance. You could have two large A's, or two of one type of allele, two of another type of allele, and then one of each. So if the little a denotes the sickle cell trait, there'd be a one in four chance, the small a's, that the offspring would inherit or express a sickle cell disease.
Right, that's great. So, and if you had a dominant condition, how would this change?
If you had a dominant, is it okay if I turn the page?
I think you can use.
Yeah. Okay.
Just this again.
Sure. If you had a dominant condition.
Could you name a dominant condition?
Yeah. So certain types of polydactyly are dominant conditions. Huntington's disease. So if you had a dominant condition, assuming that one parent would obviously have the condition themselves. So if we change it and say, let's say that the father has two big A's, Huntington's disease, whatever, there'd be a 50% chance that the offspring would get the disease as well, because there's a 50% chance that they inherit one of the defective alleles.
Great. So I want to talk to you about a different condition.
Okay.
Color blindness.
Okay.
Can you tell me anything about colorblindness?
I don't know a lot about colorblindness, but from what I have heard, it's something that's more common in men than it is in females. And there are kind of different wavelengths of colorblindness that you can get. You have red blood, you can be blind to certain wavelengths of light, so red, green.
So that's exactly right. So I want to go in more specifically. The first thing you said I thought was very interesting,
okay,
about this difference in female and male colorblindness.
Yeah.
So do you know why that is?
I haven't been told why, but I would guess that it would be to do with the genetic inheritance of it.
Mm-hmm.
For example, if it was inherited in a manner which was X-linked, and therefore which only the male would require one sort of defective copy, as they only have one X chromosome, then they'd be more likely to get it, whereas a female would have two X chromosomes, and therefore if they had it on one, they could have another X chromosome which could compensate.
Right, exactly. So colored blindness is, as you said, inherited on the X chromosome. But what we actually see in the real world is that there's a significantly smaller frequency of colorblindness in females than would be expected from the male inheritance.
Okay, can I just ask you to clarify that? So there's the smaller in females,
mm-hmm, there's fewer females who are colorblind than you would expect from the frequency in males.
Okay.
So, can you propose some reasons why this might be from your knowledge of colorblindness?
So, there's less females that are colorblind than would be expected from males.
From what you just explained about the X chromosome.
Okay. Yes. I imagine that if they had one defective X chromosome, the other one could, compensate. I'm aware that in the most conditions, or in most chromosomes, that because there's two inherited, one is kind of dampened down, I believe, and therefore perhaps if the X chromosome, the defective X chromosome, is inherited for colorblindness, if that's the X chromosome that's shut off in the two, then that trait would not be kind of manifested. I suppose that would be it.
So if we return to the Mendel square.
Sure.
So if I told you 5% of males are colorblind, how many females would you expect to be colorblind if we assume that all colorblindness is on the X chromosome?
If 5% of males are colorblind, then if you just draw. Is it okay if I just think about this for a moment?
Yes, that's all right. Take all the time you need.
If 5% of males are colorblind, then they would definitely pass the X chromosome on to their daughters, because daughters have to have two X chromosomes. So their daughter would have to be a carrier at least, and have at least one X chromosome. If their mother did not have colorblindness, or even a chromosome denoting it, was not even a carrier, then there is no chance that a female could be. I suppose it's probably easier if I try and draw it out. So if you have a male, which is, that's a big C for, and small C, so small C being sort of a colorblindness, X and Y rather. So if that's a male, he's going to pass the X chromosome on to his daughter. And if the mother is a carrier, so she has big X and small X being the colorblindness gene, then there is a 50% chance, because it all depends on which X chromosome the daughter gets. If the mother didn't have colorblindness and she wasn't even a carrier, then there's no chance that the daughter would show colorblindness, because she would not inherit two X chromosomes. She'd only inherit one at most from her mother, and she could only then be a carrier at best. And again, if the mother had no signs of colorblindness, wasn't a carrier, then yeah, there's the only chance that the daughter would be a carrier is probably the best I can explain it.
Right, so if we think about the actual numbers, so you were talking about before that the men can only have one X chromosome, and so all of their colorblindness is on that X chromosome. So 5% of males are colorblind. That means that there's an allele frequency of 5%. Yeah, so the 5% of X chromosomes are faulty. So we know that women have two X chromosomes. So given that X chromosomes are 5% faulty, what would the incidence be expected to be from that?
Well, if the mother was a carrier, if there's 1 in 20 over here, and 1 in 20 over here, it'd be a 1 in 400. But then you have to think of, it depends what the mother is. I mean, if the mother's a carrier, then there's 1 in 800, because there's a chance that the daughter might not.
Exactly. So very small, though, we're talking.
Yes.
Very small numbers here, but they're actually even smaller. And to understand that, we'll look at the protein mechanisms.
Okay.
So, do you know anything about how color vision works, the protein mechanisms of it?
I don't know.
Have you ever heard of opsin, the protein?
I've heard about it, yes, but...
So you know you have three cones,
okay.
Three types of cones, for three different colors. Red, green, and blue. So when you have genes, how do they work? How do they manifest?
They would manifest themselves in proteins. So, I mean, they're
transcript protein here.
That's right. then do a transcription translation to produce proteins in the ribosomes.
Exactly. So you have a gene and that makes a protein.
Okay.
And so opsin is a protein that's sensitive to light. So when you have these three different cones, how might the different frequencies of light be caught by these cones? Could you give a suggestion?
Different. They could have different types of protein which are encoded and which could be, I suppose, optimally excited at different frequencies of light, which would differentiate between the few.
Exactly. So we talk about three different types. We talk about short, medium, and long wavelength.
Okay.
So these short wavelengths, these prefer red, green, and blue. Yeah?
Okay.
Yeah. So these different ones get different amounts of light. So when you have these different proteins, what kind of faults do you think happen in this frequency reception?
I suppose if you had faults in the genes, which led to therefore different protein or different amino acids being encoded in a protein, they might have different sensitivities of light, and therefore this might be shifted in either direction.
Exactly. So particularly between these M and L, these can be shifted because they are actually adjacent on the X chromosome.
Okay.
So when they shift, can you imagine how that might differ between a man and a woman with two X chromosomes when you get these shifts?
So how would the same mutation in a man and a woman cause different effects over her? For a woman, obviously she has the extra X chromosome, and if that hasn't kind of, one of them hasn't been dampened down, then I presume that might be able to compensate to a certain extent.
And what if both were faulty?
If both were faulty in the woman, and obviously the mom was faulty in the man, that could manifest itself as, I suppose, if they shifted to different extents along hair. So, for example, in one, the medium and long wavelength could be right on top of each other, so they're essentially the same kind of curve, and therefore there's only two, there's only sensitivity to two different wavelengths of light, two different types of opsins. You could have the situation in which there's only a slight shift, and so there might be kind of more of an overlap. There might be no overlap between one, and more of an overlap with another wavelength of light, which again might manifest itself in different.
Right, so let's say in a man,
okay,
this one was shifted over. Yeah, so we have this one as normal, and M and L on top.
Right.
Now, in a woman, you have a second chance in that there's many ways these shifts can occur, as you say. So when you have this second X chromosome, even if it's faulty, the odds are it's not faulty for the exact same shift between these. So do you think you could propose what might happen that would make her less colorblind?
Okay. As you were saying, so with the male, you've only got one chance as such. With the female, if you had a shift, for example, like the one drawn here, on one of the X chromosomes, and on the other X chromosomes you have a shift in the other direction, for example, something like this, between the two chromosomes you've got overlap in each of the wavelengths of light, so you kind of compensate for each other.
Exactly. So this is exactly what happens in women, and this is why you see this lessening of the frequency of colorblindness in the female population.
Okay.
So it was really good to speak to you.
Okay, thank you.
And if you have any questions now?
Not now, but maybe later.
Alright, well, thank you.
That's
very nice speaking with you. How did you think that went?
I thought that it got better as it went through the interview at the beginning, kind of
it's quite hard to focus on what exactly you're supposed to be thinking about. But then as you kind of give prompts and clues as we go through and try to kind of steer me more on course, it's easier to kind of, you know, hone down on what we need to talk about and what we need to think about. So I thought it got better as it went along. As you said, once you know the topic that you're supposed to be sort of talking about, you can think back to what you learned in A-level and try and apply those concepts here. I wasn't sure at all points, you know, what the right answer was, but I felt that as long as I had a, you know, good go and a good attempt at what I thought was the right answer, you were willing to kind of work with me, and we kind of got there in the end.
Yeah, so I thought you were really good. I thought it was really great that you committed to this answer and that you didn't give up, even though it was challenging, and that you really tried and you used the different materials that I've given you here. I'm hinting that you should sketch, and it's good that you were willing to engage with that and do your best to use the diagrams appropriately. And I felt that you spoke very clearly, and you had a good eye contact and focus, and were willing to listen and engage with what I was saying to you. Very similar to what we do in the supervision system at Oxbridge.